The topic of the presentation is Driver Drowsiness Detection System. I am Saumya Prakash, and now I will continue with the second part of this presentation. Here we will focus on the implementation details and the adversarial attacks on the network. So to give a brief introduction, we have already seen why this problem is important and it has real life implications. So here we will examine the neural network in detail and see how it performs under different settings. That is, we will put the network under adversarial attacks and then use adversarial defenses mechanisms and compare the results. Our first part of the project was a research survey on image manipulation techniques and such type of adversarial attacks. Now we will try to implement the same on our neural network. Also, we will try to train the neural network using the data augmentation technique, and then we will try to compare the results. Here we have whatever model or whatever design we discuss, that all the models have been inspired from the robust sleep nets paper, which we have given in the reference. The paper implemented it for a different setting and for a different type of data set, but we have tried to study the model and then modify it according to our own problem setting. So to give an overview of the problem, like, we are basically trying to analyze the captured images of the driver. We have the image of the eye, and then we have an image of the face. Now from these two, we want to detect if the driver is drowsy or not. So our basic assumption in this whole discussion will be that closed eyes and yawning are signs of drowsiness. Like, this is a closed eye and this is a yawning face. Now, as we can see, this problem clearly belongs to the domain of image classification. We are trying to classify the images into two classes. If it is an eye image, then we want to say if it is open or closed. And if it is a face image, then we want to say if it is a yawning or not a yawning face. So for this image classification job, CNNs are best suited. Here in this sample, a neural network, we can see some convolutional layers followed by fully dense layers. In our implemented neural network too, we will follow a similar approach. Now first, let's discuss the dataset. For eye dataset has two classes. Open class has 726 images. Here we can see some sample images. Now there is a lot of variety. Like, some images are of left eye and others are of right eye. Also, some have spectacles, while some are looking in some different direction. Closed class also has 726 images. Here also there is a lot of variation in terms of spectacles, lighting condition, or the shape and overall structure. So a total of 1452 images are there. For the face dataset, again has two classes, yawning. In this dataset, we can see there is a lot of variation in terms of lighting, angle, and the background variation. No yawning has 725 images. Again, here is a lot of variation, and different angle, lighting condition, and a different background. So a total of 1448 images are there. We would like to have our model as robust as possible because it will be expected to perform well in real life situations where there can be great variation is in the camera angle or zoom angle or even the lighting conditions. So first, let's focus on the model for the eye dataset. So the neural network will have convolutional layers in the beginning and then fully connected layers at the end. We will use ReLU as the activation function in all the hidden layers, while sigmoid will be used as the output unit. Because this is a binary classification problem, then sigmoid is a good choice, as it will give a real number between 0 and 1, and from that we can infer our class. So let's discuss how we are pre-processing the data. So the eye images are of different dimensions. We resize them all to 25 cross 25. We found that these dimensions are good and enough information is stored so that our model performs reasonably well. Now the images are in RGB formats, like, they are colorful and so they have three channels, but this information is not required for our task. So we just convert it into a grayscale so that they become of one channel. Now the input doesn't have much information, and again our model does well, or we don't need to have too many parameters for the model. Now we will also split the dataset into three parts like train set, validation set and test set. And validation set will be used to tune the hyperparameters. Now let's discuss the architecture of the model. So first, the input dimension are now after pre-processing have become 25x25x1. The first layer is the convolutional layers, which has a total of 6 3x3 filters that use ReLU as the activation function. So the output is 23, 23, 6. Then an average pooling layer follows, which reduces the dimension to 11x11x6. Then we have another convolutional layers with 16 3x3 filters that use ReLU as the activation function. Output is reduced to 9x9x16. Another average pooling layer follows, which transforms the dimension to 4x4x16. Now we use a flattening layer. After flattening layer, we will be using dense layers. So if we flatten this 4x4x16, then we will get 16 squared, that is 256. Now the first dense layer will have 30 neurons, and it will take those 256 inputs from the previous layer. The next dense layer has 10 neurons. The last output layer will have one neuron, and it will use sigmoid as the activation function. Now the total number of trainable parameters in this model are around 9,000. Around 1,000 are in convolutional layer and the rest 8,000 in the dense layers. Again, the dense layers have much more number of parameters. So this is the overall model summary. Like if we say we have used 2 convolution layers, 2 average pooling layers, 1 flattening layer, and then 3 dense layers. Now first we will train without any data augmentation. So batch size we take as 32 and we use Adams optimizer in training. First we run for 200 epochs and this is the loss curve. Now we see around this region the validation loss starts to increase again. So it seems that the 75 is the optimal stopping. So we retrain the model for 75 epochs and these are the final results. Here is the loss curve and here is the accuracy curve. Now, after training the model, we test it on the test set and see that the overall accuracy is 94.86%. Now here 0 is for closed class and 1 is for open class. Here we can see the total report, like we can see precision, recall and F1 score. Also from confusion matrix, we can say that 15 samples in total were classified incorrectly. Now we will train with data augmentation. So every other parameter will remain the same. The data augmentation will try to modify the data set. So augmentation variables are as follows. We try to rotate the data, width shift, height shift, shear, zoom, and even try to horizontally flip it. So again, we try to train it for 200 epochs, and this time we see that in this region, there is an optimal stopping point. So we just retrain the model for 125 epochs, and these are the final results. This is the loss curve, and this is the accuracy curve. Again, we test it on our test set, and the overall accuracy is slightly increased to 95.21%. Again, here we can see the full report, and this time 15 samples in total were misclassified. Earlier there were 15. So it can be said that there is a slight improvement. Now we will move on to the second part, which is adversarial attacks and then adversarial training. So in this way, we will try to test the robustness of the model. So we will employ 3 types of attacks: FGSM, PGT and DeepFool. We will attack the simply trained network and then adversarially train them and then attack it again just to compare. So first let's see fast gradient sign method. If we just use a simply trained model, then accuracy is of only 50%. But if we adversarially train them and then use our adversarial samples, then it is 51.37%. So there is only a slight improvement in it. Like this model was is not very robust to the FGSM attack technique in general. Now for PGT, the accuracy on the simple test is around 80%, which is good. Like FGSM was able to reduce this around 50% mark, but this is around 80% mark. Even after training it, adversarially training it, the accuracy improves very, very slightly. But again, this is high. So we can say that the PGD failed and it is not very effective on the model. Now for the DeepFool, it lies somewhere in between PGD and FGSM. It did better than PGD, but still it could only reduce to 63.01%. Again, adversarially training didn't do any improvement to the model. So overall, we can say that the FGSM was the most effective against our model, while the PGD was the least effective against our proposed model. Now let's move to the face dataset. Here, our overall approach remains the same, that we'll be using CNNs and then fully connected layers. But there are a lot more variations in the dataset, as we can see, as we have discussed earlier also. So we will try to increase the capacity of the model by adding extra layers. We tried to use the same network that we used in the I model and for this face dataset also, but the training accuracy was not very good. It clearly showed that the capacity of the model was not enough to fit the data. So now we also did some changes to the input. Like we now reduced the size of the image to 40x40 instead of 25x25. 25x25 was not working well. So we think that 40x40 has enough information so that a neural network does well. Again, we are using grayscale images only, like we are converting from three channels to one channel. Color or RGB information is not very relevant to our task. Now there are changes to the architecture as well, like we add more layers. So first layer is again a convolutional layers which has 6 3x3 filters and uses ReLU as the activation function. And then an average pooling layer follows. Now these two layers are same as they were in the I neural network. But then we have more convolutional layers. First we add a slightly larger filter of 4x4. Then we add another layer of 4x4. And then we start to add a smaller filter. By adding larger filters, we want to make the model less sensitive to the background variations, or our intuitions is on the same line. And then after 4x4, we add many 2x2 filters. Like first we add 8 2x2 filters, then again in another layer we add again 8 2x2 filters, then again 8 2x2 filters. Finally, we do a average pooling and reduce the output dimension to 5x5x8. Now we flatten the layer and so we obtain a total of 5x5x8, 200. Now our dense layers start. First we have 30 units that use ReLU as the activation function. Then we have 10 units which again uses ReLU as the activation function. Now the output layer has only one unit and it uses sigmoid as the activation function. It is again a binary classification problem. So the total number of parameters are around 7,700. In the convolutional layer, there are around 1,400 parameters, and in the dense layers, there are around 6,400 parameters. So again, dense layers have more parameters. So this is the overall model summary. There are many more layers if we compare it to the previous I model. Like clearly there are four extra layers. So there are a total of 6 convolutional layers, 2 average pooling layers, and then 3 dense layers. In the intermediate, we have 1 flattening layer. Now this is the overall training result, that we again take batch size 10, number of epochs is 100, and we again use item optimizer. The final accuracy is around 88.65%. Here we can see the final report card. From this matrix, we can see around 96 of the samples were misclassified. Now this accuracy is good, but there are a lot of misclassifications. Now we again try to do the adversarial attack and defense. Now for the FGSM, we see that before the FGSM could reduce the accuracy to 61.11%. In the I model, it was able to reduce it to 50%, but this model seems to be a little robust. But after training with FGSM adversarial samples, the accuracy didn't improve. We suspect that the overall conditioning of the dataset has to be improved, and even the capacity of model has to be improved. Now if you see the PGT, again the PGT also reduced it to around 60% mark, and even after training it with adversarial samples, it was about the same, 61.11. So again, it could not do much, like the model couldn't be improved even after adversarial training. Now if you look at DeepFool, again it was around the same 60% mark, and training it also didn't do much effect. So the overall reason that we suspect is the pre-processing or the conditioning of the input before it is fed into the neural network. Also, we may have to use a larger network so that it can accommodate or learn more features. Now for the implementation details, all the code is written in Python, and Keras library is used for the general neural network operations. To test the to do the adversarial attacks and defenses, we use Adversarial Robustness Toolbox ART. Google Colab is used as the computing engine, and the links to the Google Colab notebooks are available. Like we can see the Google Colab notebook, like this is for the I model with all the required libraries installed and all the functions defined separately. Then this is for the face model, which has similar in structure, but for its which is similar in structure to the I model, but it has some different tweaks done to its architecture so that it can work well on the face dataset. Both of these notebooks are accessible, and the links are available in the description and the comment section. So for the future scope, we can clearly say that the yawn detection can be improved. And also, instead of working on a statically captured image, we can work on a video stream. Now we started with very basic assumption, but there are other signs of drowsiness as well, such as blinking frequently or head dropping or even getting distracted or eye moving too much. All these things can be looked into and developed further. This was our main reference, like this paper, Robust Sleep Nets, was trying to address the same problem, but it used a slightly different data set and focused only on opening and closing of eyes. It didn't focus on yawn. So our neural networks in this presentation were inspired from this paper only. For the yawning, we had to do a little experiment and then modify it, adding extra layers and also pre-processing the data so that it fit our own problem setting. With this, I conclude the presentation. Thank you.